No?
Yeah, all right. We have sound.
No?
Yeah,
no?
You're good. Okay. Okay. All right.
In this manner.
Can you get, is it going to PowerPoint?
Yep, you got okay. It. Well, good evening. It is a pleasure to share with you our research, and thanks to Robert Racker and all the organization of this conference for the Shroud of Turin in Pasco to accept our involvement. This presentation had prepared by the president of the Spanish Center of Syndonology and myself. But Jorge Manuel Rodriguez Almenar, the president, just read his doctoral thesis 2 days ago. Then he cannot. Attend this meeting. But this is the cover of his thesis. Well, but in fact, the title of this presentation is the image of Edessa include the whole body. This part is also listening today in this hall, in this room, but only its empty reliquary arrived at Paris. This is a novelty, just against the previous presentation. Well, that is, the image of Edessa include the whole body, but only the empty reliquary arrived to Paris. If you are in a hurry, this is the summary of my presentation. I don't like to insist on the legend of the image of Edessa. I assume you know the main point of this history, in this legend. But I would like to remark that the consensus that the image of Edessa only show the face. Okay, but the image of Edessa is clearly documented that arrived to Constantinople. The 15th August, the image reached Constantinople, and the next day, the 16th August, the image remains in the Pharaoh's palace, in the Pharaoh's chapel, in the palace complex, after some ritual for the arriving. Well, since the image reached Constantinople, official tests speak of blood and whole body that are incompatible with what the image was supposed to be. Then something had to happen to change, to justify the evolution of the legend. We think the shroud was inside the reliquary of the image of Edessa, and people in Constantinople look the whole sheet. Then the question is if the image of Edessa could be the shroud. I remember some document, some manuscript that had been presented today, but it's good to repeat to learn. The Constantine the 17th, the seventh Porphyrogenetus write the narratio de imagine edessana in the 10th century. But in this case, he tell the usual legend about the image, but for the first time provide an alternative to the Asgard legend. He said, when Christ was about to go to death, he was seen to pray, sweet dropped from him like drop of blood. He took this piece of cloth with which we see now from one of the disciples and wiped off the drop of sweat on it. Then the presence of blood in the image of Edessa. And also the Gregory the Referendarius tell also about the presence of blood. Then this is the first clue that the image of Edessa could be the Shroud of Turin. But there are a lot of documents that contradict the legend by expressly saying that the image of Edessa had the whole body in the image printing. Well, a manuscript of the 10th century. The Sinasarium. Asgard, the king, asked the messenger Hanan to draw a description of the face and the hair and of his whole body. And the Codex Bosianus, in Jesus' letter to Asgard, he said, if you want to see my face, I will send you this cloth, in which you will see not only my face, but also my whole body, divinely transformed. The Smera Tractatus, translated from Syriac into Latin, said that Asgardus received a lintel in which he could see, in Latin, facie figuram septotius corporis figuram cernere poteris. Most of the tests here are showing in English, but the original are in other languages, and each translation have an interpretation. But in this case, I can show the original. The translation can be not only the face, but the figure of the whole body. A manuscript of the speech of the Pope Stephen III in the Lateran Synod used identical phrases. The same mediator between God and men laid out his whole body, stretched on a linen cloth white as snow, on which the glorious image of the face of the Lord and the most noble length of the whole body was suddenly transferred by divine will, so that for whom could not see the Lord physically in the flesh, it was enough to then to see the transfiguration operated on the cloth. That cloth, despite the time elapsed, remained uncorrupted in Mesopotamian Syria in the city of Edessa within the Greek church. And now I would like to remark that on major fest it is taken out of a chest of gold. It's important in my presentation to insist that the image, the cloth, was inside a box, a reliquary. In the Greek word is teka. In Latin, nos solum faciem mi figuram, sed totius corporis mei cernere poteris. more manuscript around the 11th century, the monk Christopher of Mytilene in an hymn of jambin verse. You have printed your face in a cloth, you who, after your death, you were wrapped in it as your last garment. Well, the Mandylion translation to Constantinople became a Byzantine religious festivity that is still commemorated, the 16th of August. The Synasarium, a liturgical calendar where the feasts are explained for August the 16th, says that the Acheropoietus, the not made by hand man, linen cloth was delivered, folded, with a wood and in a gold frame in Persian style. Well, this is a hypothetical reconstruction of the reliquary. And the references made at Tractatus adds that the image was preserved in a reliquary, that it was exposed in exceptional circumstances and every year on Easter Day. The Smera Tractatus should be written before the Islamic domination, because afterward the image was not more shown. It is important that this object, this relic, was linked, associated to festivity and to ritual. Now I make a parenthesis to explain why the nimbus around the Jesus Christ hid. This is a new hypothesis, but Jorge Manuel, the president, proposed that could italic be the first cover of the image. Well, this is an explanation that give the reason for three features of the Mandylion: the circle around the head, the lines in the edge, and the fringe. The talit has all these three features. The talit was a piece of the Jewish culture. The talit replaced the tabernacle and represent the glory of God and His presence. And the image of Edessa was considered the evidence of the incarnation, and its sacred character would be at least equivalent to the word of God and His own name. And this is the several representation of the Mandylion that maybe was covered by a royal mantle and a golden fabric with a brocade in relief on the talit. I remark the presence of the fringes. And this is our hypothesis. The image of Edessa was covered with a talit. Maybe it's not true, but by the moment, on my knowledge, is the best explanation of the several characteristics of the Mandylion. This setup completes the symbolic meaning. The image was considered the perfect symbol of the incarnation. The talit represents the divinity, and the golden mantle, the royalty. Symbology similar to the gold, incense, and myrrh of the three wise men. Well, I follow with the comparison in the image of Edessa and the South of Turin with a new document. Alfred Rambo referred to an unusual custom. In the throne room, where the Basilius, the emperor, welcomes the ambassador, beside his lofty throne of gleaming gold, there is another empty. It is the throne of the true king. Sometimes, as a symbol, the gospel or some venerated image, like that of the Edessa, is placed on the throne, which, by discretion, respect, and modesty, is double, tetradiplon, and enclosed in its precious frame. Well, this is a ritual that had to be conserved, saved for years. When something is repeated year after year, it's difficult to eliminate. Then if we have an object that is linked to this ritual, we have to conserve, to save the object. And the modesty. Does the term modesty refer to the resistance of Byzantine art to showing the naked body of the shroud? It's only a question. But, the problem to assimilate, to identify image of Edessa and shroud of Turin is that these two relics are in two places, in two different places. The shroud in two places, the bilocation is not a characteristic of the shroud. Nobody told us, but was the before mentioning Crusader Robert de Clary that told us about a burial shroud with image. That is important to differentiate the burial cloth that lot of documents say the burial cloth, but the burial cloth with image is that, is the only relic, only cloth that can be the shroud of Turin, because cloth of the burial can be anything. And the test already listening in this conference, there was another monastery which was called My Lady St. Mary of Blackernet, where there was the Siduan, is the exact word the Clary used, a shroud, in which our Lord has been wrapped, which every Friday raised itself upright. So that one could see well the figure of our Lord on it. But no one knew, neither Greek nor French, what has been of the cloth when the city was taken. Well, now a new data, never told on my knowledge, that style of art, the type of exhibition, will have originated the icon, the Man of Sorrow, the Imago Pietatis, as today had exposed. Some iconographical feature, always standing, coming out the tomb, something held by angels, often with the seat behind. As in this case, the angel and the seed, arm crossed on the body, four finger in its hand, and head tilted to the right. But this is the novelty. This setup showed the front of the man. But the shroud of Turin had two images, the front and the dorsal part of the man. If this was the shroud of Turin, the people can see the frontal of the man, but what will be on the backside of this What if this were the Shroud of Turin, in the back side will be the back of the man? Do you understand? We found an evidence of this setup. Several Imago Pietatis, man of sorrow, have the back of the man in the back side of the canvas. We found three examples of this fact. And I propose you, if you find a picture, a painting of the man of sorrow in some museum or church, ask for permission to turn around the canvas, because maybe you and even the owner can find a surprise. But this confirms that this way was the Shroud of Turin, no other. Okay. But Robert de Clary saw that can be the Shroud of Turin in the Church of Blackernard in the north of the city. And the same person saw the Mandilion, the image of Edessa, in another place, in the Greek Palace, in a very important place. The Mandilion was kept in the Faro Chapel in the Imperial Complex, hanging on a silver chain, along with a miraculous copy of it on a tile, the Keramion. Then Keramion and Mandilion was in a main place in the main chapel of the palace complex. And if the Mandilion was in a place and the Shroud in another place, cannot be the same. It's impossible. Even more, the Mandilion, the image of Edessa, as we saw just in the previous presentation, arrived to Paris in the power of Saint Louis the IX, who constructed the Saint-Chapelle. And this is also shown engraving of the 13th century, represent the Greek, the Grand Chas of the Reiki. And, well, I can say, is the reliquary that was preserved in the Grand Chas. But what reaches Paris? 20 years ago or more, I and other members of the Spanish Center saw samples of the relics of the Grand Faro Chapel in Constantinople, because the collection of relics of Constantinople were sent to Paris. And Saint Louis took samples of this relic and sent to some relatives of the Europe, among them Fernando III in Spain. And this collection remained in Spain in Toledo. And we open every reliquary and open its back and show and take picture of the relic. Only send 9 samples of the relic. And one of the samples was from the burial cloths. Then I know now that the burial cloth in Constantinople that arrived to Paris and a part go to Toledo is not the south of Turin, is not part of the south of Turin because the tissue is different. Then burial cloth in the treasure of Constantinople was not the south of Turin. The south of Turin was not in the Pharos Chapel or was the Mandylion. But we saw that the in Constantinople already the shroud was in other place. What reaches Paris? Our hypothesis is the image of Edessa was placed in a Byzantine reliquary. The Byzantine reliquaries were closed and the cover showed an image of the content. This is important. The Byzantine reliquaries in the Constantinople were sent to Paris, but Saint Louis changed the reliquaries. This was closed, and the reliquaries in the Saint Chapel was transparent with crystal, with quartz, transparent to can see. The culture was very different. In Byzantine, there are a respect to the relic, and in the Western culture, they would to see. Then, if we read the document with this new idea that the people show box when pilgrims go to the palace and was told, there are the towel that Jesus Christ used to dry the feet. The people don't see any cloth, see a box, a reliquary. Then, with this in mind, it's possible to find an explanation of the two places for the same relic. And a new manuscript, the Tarragonensis 55, the relic, speaking about the image of Edessa, the relic with the face of the Redeemer was enclosed in a golden vessel and was no longer shown to the public, nor even the emperor. Then, this confirmed with the document that people saw a box. Robert de Clary saw two boxes, two reliquary, one for the Mandylion, another for the Keramion in the Pharos, and saw a cloth with image in Blanquernas. Within, the Mandylion and the shroud can be the same. Many people think as us. But in some moment, the shroud was extracted from its reliquary. This also agree with Mario. Mario think the shroud and the Mandylion are the same, within the same. And he think in some moment the shroud was extracted from the reliquary, but we don't agree at the moment. We think the people venerate an empty box already in Constantinople to keep the important tradition linked to the Mandylion. All the ritual with the Mandylion was preserved with the reliquary, but the great astonishment, the surprise of see a whole image was used for another event, another ritual. What riches Paris? Well, the Byzantine reliquaries were replaced by Gothic reliquaries, but not all. The Mandylion was not replaced. And the documents say, the inventories in Paris say that there are no clothes. Then is a clue that the Mandylion was only the box. The box just was the reliquary, an empty reliquary. That's all. The empty box.
Now I have some testing. Hello. So now I want you to know something. I was born in Paris, so I'm hurt that the Shroud did not actually go to the Saint Chapelle, because.